Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And, you know, it's thank you for your patience and flexibility and all that, you know, because I couldn't finish the presentation last time. It was a little bit of a hectic night for us. But anyway, so before I start the presentation, this may not be news for some of you, I guess, but it was a new development for me that the Raspbian OS released the 64-bit for the Pi 4, I think, like Bullseye version. So I just bought a Pi 400 and installed it, and it works beautifully. And you know, so, it doesn't have the direct link on the website, but if you go to the downloads folder through, I believe it's FTP. Like you get the FTP kind of like file listing some in some link in some place. Again, there's no direct link there, but you can download the 64-bit image and kind of like flash it to the, you know, the SD card and use it that way. And I can try to find it, you know, if there's and post it or something if there's problem finding it. So anyway,
pretty cool. Thank you.
No problem. So you know, we I think had some discussion after the incomplete presentation last time because of some remarks that I made about you know, like the kind of like about reliability of better FS and you know, especially under in the setting of using like multiple drives and things like that. And I guess my intention was to first do no harm, you know, when I was presenting this. So again, you know, I just didn't want to mislead people believing that this is like a totally like ready file system, like ZFS or ZFS, for example. I think I wanted to give that as a initial message, whereas the rest of my presentation was more about like the advantages and the great features of the ButterFS, which I didn't end up mentioning because the presentation was, you know, cut short. So yeah, I apologize for that if you know, I kind of like misled in the opposite way that I was worried about misleading, you know, people. But you know, we reviewed about multiple features of ButterFS. You know, I think we mentioned the copy on write feature. We, you know, talked about compression options. We talked about like sub volumes, and I think we were somewhere around like the snapshot property. I don't remember where exactly I left, but snapshotting a sub volume in ButterFS is simply kind of like sharing its data and metadata with some other sub volume using the CAU capabilities of ButterFS. A writable snapshot in this sense is exactly the, you know, like the mirror image of the original, like the sub volume. Whereas a read-only, you know, snapshot is a, like a read-only version of that, which cannot be modified, which probably, you know, has its own advantages. The read-only snapshots can also not be moved. So just to keep in mind. There are a couple of ways to roll back to a snapshot. I think I mentioned them, but the first one is moving the original sub-volume to a temporary location and then moving the snapshot in the place of the original sub-volume, assuming that the snapshot is not read-only, and then mounting the like the location of the original sub-volume now containing the snapshot actually. And then once confirming that it works, removing the temporary location where the like the original sub-volume exists at the moment. Alternatively, you can first delete the original sub-volume if you are a little bit bolder, I suppose, and then snapshotting the snapshot to the place of the original subvolume which you deleted in the previous step, and then mounting that, supposed to work the same way. This kind of like, obviously brings the good feature of like snapshotting the snapshots, which is possible, because snapshots are just like original subvolume, they are subvolumes, so they can be treated as any subvolume, essentially. Warning here in the articles that I read is the snapshots of the volumes that are visible to any user will remain visible to any user. So, if you want to hide stuff, that should be kept in mind, I suppose. The other thing about snapshots is, you cannot make a snapshot of a subvolume in a device, let's say device, SDA1 or like the partition or whatever. You cannot make it on the SDB. It has to be on the same device, physical device, that is. There's gotta be space, although the space is less of a limitation because of the copy on write features of the Butterfs file system. Again, it's important to remember that the snapshot has to be on the same device. Now, having said that, snapshots can be sent to other device after being created. So first you create the snapshot, even like a read-only snapshot. Remember, you cannot move that, but you can send that. That's kind of like a little dip, terminology here. Then pipe it to a Butterfs receive command on the recipient device, which will receive the snapshot and copy it. This is very similar to, I think, rsync function, but the recipient drive or the recipient device needs to be like formatted with Butterfs to be able to do this. And if it is not, then you gotta use the old good rsync for this purpose, I suppose. So you create an incremental backups or snapshots are also possible because of this send receive command coupling. So first you send the initial snapshot to the secondary device, let's say an external hard drive, and then work on the project the whole day and start a new day, etc. Create a new snapshot on that same device, original device, internal hard drive, and then send an incremental copy to the external hard drive. And this is kind of like the command to do that. The dash P, option here stands for the parent snapshot. So the parent is the like the original snapshot in the original device, followed by the new snapshot that you are creating there. And then you send it to the external drive in this example with the receive command. That will create an incremental snapshot on the external drive, not a totally new snapshot, I suppose. I hope it's a little bit confusing, and I hope I could make it clear. Remember, snapshots are not backups, especially considering that they do exist on the same device. So technically it doesn't qualify for a backup, but once you send it to the secondary drive and take that external hard drive in this example and make it offline or something and then move it to another location, then it may qualify for a backup perhaps in that sense. Butterfs also has the capability of defining quotas for subvolumes, but it has to be defined before the subvolume is added or created. If it wasn't enabled at the creation of the subvolume, they can then be enabled and then a Q group, like a quota group, is created for each subvolume using the subvolume ID and like rescanning them with the following confusing command here, to me at least. rescan the path and then define the Q group limit, not on the subvolume, but on the Q group, I suppose. That's how you do it, I suppose. It's a nice additional feature. SSD trim capability is also available for ButterFS file system for using like flash drives and SSD drives and all that. It's like a mounting option, which is indicated by discard equals to async, kind of like a mounting option here. In my FSTEP file, for example, original like the system partition, like the root partition, is a ButterFS read write kind of like a subvolume, and then I have a boot subvolume, which is not a ButterFS subvolume, but this is like a regular VFAT subvolume, and then home subvolume, I should say, is a ButterFS subvolume. This has the discard async option, as you see here, because these are like both SSDs, and ButterFS can kind of like account for that. So much for the where cache subvolume as well. That is, I think, about the SSD trim option. Other aspects of the the ButterFS file system is the regular file system usage comments like df or du will not give accurate output for ButterFS file system because of the copy on write feature. Instead of them, you are supposed to use the following kind of like command structure, starting with like ButterFS, then file system, and either like df or du or usage, followed by the path of the like the root or home subvolume or whatever, essentially. I'll show an example of this in my computer here. But the one that I like best is the usage, because you can tabulate it in a table format, and it is a little bit more human readable, in my opinion, for an average user like me at least. All right. The other aspect of the ButterFS file system is the file system checking tool, which is the ButterFS scrum command, essentially, instead of fschk kind of like command that you use for X4 or other Linux file systems. It reads all the data and metadata on the file system and uses checksums and the duplicate copies from storage to identify and repair any corrupt data. Then while it is running, you can kind of like check the status of it with the the status option. It's recommended to do this like on a regular basis. I defined like a cron tab, like a cron job for this, to do it like weekly on my the server, but on my laptop I do it whenever I remember, I suppose. It's because it's not always on and stuff like that. It can be started by systemd timer or all that. What it says is may need to limit the rate of scrubbing by the following option in NVMe drives and laptops to prevent overheating of the drive, because it kind of like does a aggressive job, I suppose. The other option that you can use with the ButterFS command is the balance subcomment, I should say. This is meant for correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this is meant for resilvering, I guess is the term, like when you have a like a drive in your like multiple drive array, like the RAID array, for example, that is gone corrupt or degraded is the term, I think. You're supposed to replace that drive with a like a new drive, and then run the balance option to kind of restore that degraded volume back to the functional ungraded status, I suppose. But you know, it is not recommended. Again, it is not recommended to use BudgerFS across multiple drives at this current stage, at least. Therefore, I don't know if it's something recommendable to, you know, overemphasize this or talk more about this. There are flaws in this subcomment in the article that I read, which I can show you what it is. You know, and maybe you have a better idea about what it is and how viable this option is, essentially. The snapshots that you create, especially for the like the system, like the root sub volume, are like bootable into. And there is a package in the you know the Arch Linux, at least like the grub dash butterfs package, that is, it will automatically populate the boot menu of the like the grub config file with butterfs snapshots. So whenever you can program the system whenever you run like a sudo pacman dash syu, which is like the you know, like the updating the system, like upgrade, kind of like a combination for Debian systems. Whenever you run those commands, you know, this package creates a new kind of like a boot point, you know, like a, almost like a, the feature of like Windows XP's, you know, I forgot what it was called, but like a restart point or, you know, some point.
System restore point.
System restore point. Thank you so very much. Yes, yes, that is that. I'm not sure about an alternative. I'm sure there is one, but I don't know what it is in the Debian ecosystem. There are a couple of options to create snapshots and working with them. Number one, you can just issue the commands, you know, like from the command line interface, like just type it. Or create like a shell script, which you can then point to by a, like a cron job that does this like regularly and stuff like that. And there are GUI options like time shift, snapper, with or without GUI, and probably some others, which I'm gonna kind of like show the time shift, which is what I have on my system. But I also use the shell scripting option on my server, at least, to kind of like do it more routinely and all that. This is the kind of like the shell script file that I have. It's like very primitive, I would say, at like 1 a.m. Of every day, every night, the butterfs creates a sub volume, like read-only sub volume of the root partition under snapshot sub volume with the current date in a certain format, underscore system. And then like forwards the log into this file. And 1 minute later, because it takes like really few seconds to do this, 1 minute later, you kind of like create another snapshot from the home sub volume this time with a underscore home, kind of like a name under the snapshot subvolume, and then you delete the former versions of them in the next couple of minutes. I keep like 6 copies of these for the last 6 days. This is way overkill probably, but just for the sake, peace of mind kind of like sake. And it doesn't occupy a lot of space, honestly. I mean, it's the good part of this. And then at 104, after you know all these subvolumes are created and deleted and recycled and rotated and all that, an rsync job sends you know this newly created snapshot into an rsync server, you know, to kind of like create a remote copy, both for the system and the home directories, essentially. And at 1:30 every Sunday, there's a scrub job that starts for the system, like the root folder, as well as the home folder or subvolume, I suppose. And kind of like reports the status of that into the log file, essentially. You know, and you know, this is again what I was able to come up with. There is probably a million better versions of this that can be, you know, kind of like done. Now, first of all, let's, before the time shift menu, this is kind of like the, you know, like the command I was kind of mentioning earlier, butterfs, file system, usage, dash capital T, let's say root file system here. It just gives an output like this. Can you see the screen still? Or are you still on the presentation?
It didn't load properly for me, so I'm not sure if you could reload the screen.
Sure. I'm going to go to here,
essentially. I don't know if it's not, if it's painting well for everyone else. Can that you looks now? Great. There much better.
Yeah. So this is the command here, butterfs file system usage, dash capital T, then the path, which is the root file system. It gives you like a nice tabular format with a, like an estimated free space on the drive. So the total size is like 200 gigabytes, and I have about like 160 gigabytes of free space. And mind you, this has, I think, 8 or so snapshots of the like the root file system here. So like very stingy use of the whole file system, including the snapshots and everything. Now, this is the laptop I'm using, the framework laptop that I was very fond of, and I kind of like mentioned a couple of times, I think, in the Slack and everything. You know, it comes with like modular units that you can actually choose from to add on the side panel of the laptop for example, USB-A output, USB-C output, HDMI output. There is no Ethernet output yet, but you know, I think there's a request for that, which they are hopefully working on. And the other modular unit is an external hard drive, like 1 terabyte hard drive, which is like a smaller than a matchbox kind of like a unit that you can actually insert to the side of the laptop, which works as an external USB drive. So I use it as a like a, you know, secondary backup for those snapshots, etc., with the send receive command that I kind of like mentioned earlier. You know, it's kind of like under the MNT. This is part English, part Turkish. You know, sorry about that. Yedek is backup in Turkish. So, you know, there's also another like a snapshots, you know, like a subvolume there. If you can kind of like this there, those are like snapshots there. And if we, for example, run a butterfs file system usage dash T, you know, with all these snapshots and everything, the used space is only like 24 gigabytes. You know what I mean? So it is, I think, very efficient in terms of, you know, like the using the file available drive space, I would say. You know, that is the thing that I like. And when you navigate into every one of these folders, let's say CD snapshots and CD, these are the dates, obviously, 21, 11, 06, 12, 19. This is the whole file system. like the root, like snapshot of the root subvolume essentially. Like each one of them have like a snapshot like that, yet they only use like 24 gigabytes total because of the like the copy on write and sharing the metadata, I guess, stuff. It's butterfest magic. I mean, I am not proficient enough to explain this, to be honest with you. But anyway, so that is, I think, an excellent future. I mean, I'm really, you know, enjoying that kind of like feature of ButterFS here. So that's the time shift is the next demo, which I'm going to hopefully share next. And this is the interface of the, like the GUI. I don't know, you can see it, right? Right?
Yep, yes. It just went very bright.
Yeah, so it lit up the room. It's very pretty.
Sorry.
Yeah, that looks amazing.
It is very lovely, really. You can manually create a snapshot anytime that you like. And there is a, you know, like a setting option here. You choose the snapshot type either by rsync or ButterFS. Obviously, rsync is the choice that you're going to choose if you don't have a ButterFS file system. But if you do, then ButterFS has superiority to that because it is so fast. And I will show you how long it takes. These are the available disks that are formatted with ButterFS that you can actually snapshot. This is the system disk that I am creating the snapshots of. And this is the external drive that I was talking about, like the 1 terabyte. Then you create a schedule, like daily, keep one daily copy, and then I guess, you know, that is what it does. You can also choose this, but what I did was the, you know, like you can create a snapshot with every boot just for, you know, like accidental situations, etc. But because I'm using that Arch package that I mentioned earlier, with every system upgrade, there's an additional snapshot that is created. You know, I didn't choose anything other than a daily snapshot here, essentially. And then you have the option to include the home subvolume in backups. This is not recommended because when you, undo changes or restore that snapshot, you're going to probably use some like documents or files that you edited in the meantime. Reverting the system is a safer thing than reverting your home subvolume, if that makes sense. Was I able to explain it well? Yeah. So that is like a edition management or like the Git, I guess. You know what I mean? Like you want to keep the latest copy, essentially. And the date format you can create and everything like that. And then, you know, it's kind of like becomes kind of like the part of the thing. I don't know why this thing is there, but just as a side note, I did update the darn laptop yesterday because, you know, Arch, it just included a kernel update to 5.15-2, and some drivers do not agree with the laptop anymore. I lost Bluetooth and, you know, things like that. So I'm suffering from like Arch blues a little bit right now. Not everything is working as expected, but.
Have you looked at using Etsy Keeper?
No, I have not.
Oh, as an Arch user, it is mandatory.
Is that right?
Yes. So do you know what Etsy Keeper is?
No, I do not.
Okay, so imagine you have a Git optimized for looking at your / Etsy folder. Ooh. And anything that does configurations, and it also keeps track of new packages that you install, so you can go back in history and see what changes from each time. Ooh. You've made a major change. Yeah.
That sounds awesome, actually. Thank you for telling me that.
Yeah. When you're done with this and we hit the stop button on the recording, I'll share your screen and I'll walk you through how to install and get it set up. It's glorious.
Awesome. Thank you so very much. I would love to try that for sure. So that is the thing. And there's a like little wizard here that kind of like goes through the thing that we, I think, just did previously. You know what I mean? Like the settings kind of like thing. You're supposed to be able to browse any snapshots by clicking the browse, but it is not working for me for whatever reason, and so forth. So that's the time shift on a nutshell, I suppose. Now, if we go back to the other virtual desktop here. Now, let's try to make a snapshot of the root file system. Let's see, do I have snapshots here? I think, sorry. Yes, I do. Okay. So of course, you know, when you're doing a snapshot, you gotta do like sudo privileges. Sudo betterfs subvolume snapshot. Root like file system under snapshots. I think, let's, before doing that, let's see what is available under snapshots, because I can create a snapshot right there without any problem. Okay, sudo betterfs subvolume snapshot root into snapshots. Let's see if it's gonna work. Because, yeah. Okay, well, maybe this is that way. This way. Okay, then go back to this. I'm sorry, and not snapshot inappropriate IO control for device. All right. Well,
don't worry. The demo gods normally demand a blood sacrifice. Yes,
exactly. So I'll try one more thing and then not bother you any longer. But let's see. Yes. So this is where I think I keep my script. Betterfs diff backup. So that's. Forget about it. I'm sorry, guys. I mean, here we go. Well, here it is. There is a subvolume snapshot. There are. Okay, so maybe I can just copy this darn thing here instead of like. How about that? Hopefully. Oh well, here you go. So it does work. You gotta trust me. Maybe we can maybe we can try it with the time shifts. Hopefully it works better than this one. Just to show you how long it takes, I suppose, but it takes really seconds. And I'm not sure why it is failing me because of the demo gods, I suppose. As
question for you. Did you learn the majority of how to use ButterFS through the Arch Wiki, or did you use a different resource?
It was a combination of Arch Wiki as well as the link that I'm going to show you shortly, which is... just a sec, sorry. Which is... this one here, that is the ButterFS sysadmin guide, which is butterfs.wiki.kernel.org. This is like a very valuable resource I think these are the programmers of like the maintainers of the BadgerFS file system, and they write in simple terms even for me to understand. You know what I mean? I can kind of like follow them very easily, just like you can follow the ArchWiki. And this is the article that I was referring to in terms of the dependability of the BadgerFS in like multiple drive settings at Ars Technica. It's published in September, so fairly recent, you know. And I got all of these like cautionary messages, you know, from this article, because this guy tried all sorts of like different RAID options, etc., all that, and at the end he came up with this like BadgerFS RAID arrays RMS essentially. He doesn't recommend unless you are working on an experimental data that you don't mind losing, and you know, things like that. So, sorry.
Thank you.
Was I able to answer the question?
You answered it perfectly. Thank you.
No problem at all. So that is BadgerFS. I mean, in the example of like deleting that Docker volume, I went to the sub volume, one of those like sub volumes here that you see, like the snapshots. I like from the command line, I browse into that, and then grab the sub, like the Docker volume that I deleted, and moved it or copied it to its original location, and I was happy as a clam. You know, it worked as a charm. Like really, it was very, very helpful in that case. So see, this is, what time is it now? 8:08. So this is the, you know, like the snapshot I just created. Like it took literally seconds, you know, to kind of like, you know, create this snapshot. Like when I can show it one more time. Here we go. This is it, done. Here's another snapshot I just created. And it's the whole file system, really. You know, you can, of course, you know, delete it. It takes seconds again. And that kind of like the script that I was trying to show earlier, right here. This little kind of like a BadgerFS differential backup script that I kind of like very amateurishly kind of like wrote myself. I put like sleep comments here because I am just worried that because the script runs in like 2 seconds, including creating the initial snapshot and then sending it to the external USB drive I'm talking about, which is the second command down the road. But the whole darn script runs like in 1 second. You know, and I was worried that, well, maybe, you know, sometimes how scripts kind of like jump through commands prematurely, etc. I was worried that, well, maybe there's an incomplete snapshot being created and not sent completely, etc. So I intentionally put like sleep comments here just to allow enough time, but it doesn't seem to make a difference, honestly, other than you end up waiting for 5 seconds on each step just for peace of mind. But it does seem to work without that command completely, but I admittedly I didn't do like a exhaustive analysis of that, to be honest with you. But anyway, sorry.
But it makes you feel better.
Yes.
and if anyone ever complains the script is too slow, you have a really easy way to speed it up. You can just change those to 4s.
That's right. Absolutely. Gain 2 seconds, right?
Yeah, exactly. And then another couple of years, do it again.
So that's all there is to it, essentially. That's all I have.
Oh, the framework, the laptop, right?
Yes.
He talked about it. But unfortunately, it's kind of hard to show it off, except for when the camera is on the device itself there.
Sure, I thought about that. Now, first, I want to show the website, which you can obviously like navigate.
So that's the one to the website. Yes, this presentation.
Correct. Wow. Correct.
It was looking and acting a little mad, like, so I found choosing a different option to do that so that we could show. Oh, I guess. This,
I thought it looked like that too.
This is the device. You know, it comes. I bought the like the. How can I scroll around this? Let's see if I can move my picture from here. Maybe you can see it better than me. But it arrives unassembled to you, just like this. If you choose to do that, because if you want to buy the assembled option, you gotta pay another $100 extra or something. So if you buy the unassembled option, it's cheaper. It comes like this. One of these is like RAM, the other one is the Wi-Fi module, etc. And then you kind of like assemble this. This is the main board. This is the battery. I think the main board battery and the like the anything but the keyboard is assembled. You assemble the Wi-Fi module and the RAM, and then assemble the front face of the laptop, which is the keyboard, on top of those. You can choose to get in like a new bezel like this in a different color, etc. There are like hard switches for the camera and the microphone on the bezel. So you can actually kind of like turn it like hardware, turn off the camera and the microphone for like the privacy sensible individuals. You know what I mean? So that is a like a good feature. Let's see if I have a picture of those modules that I was talking about earlier. Not on the front page, looks like, but maybe if you go to the support.
It very much looks like a Mac book that's actually repairable.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And that is the, I think that is the whole philosophy here.
How do you like it in terms of fit and finish? Like, does the hinge hold? Do you like the way the screen looks? Do the trackpad and keyboard feel good?
I mean, the keyboard is not comparable to a whatchamacallit, like the IBM, the Lenovo ThinkPad, like the classical, like the mechanic keyboard I'm talking about. It doesn't compare to that. But when you compare it to a similar laptop with the, like the modern keyboard, kind of like the quality, the key travel is quite well. You know what I mean? So when you push the key, it travels quite a bit before it clicks and takes and stuff like that. So I like that essentially very much. The screen quality is amazing. I mean, I think that's the best part that I like about this laptop. The screen is so bright and so, you know, like vivid colors and everything like that. It is amazing. These are the units I'm talking about. So you have like four replaceable units on the exterior. And if you look under the hood here, there is a USB-C connection. So the unit that you are putting here, I wish I was a little bit more prepared for this. I apologize for it, but the unit on one side has a like a USB-C connector that goes under the hood and clicks to there. Let's magnify this. So on the just internal, like just under here, do you see my cursor?
Yes.
Just under here is a like a female USB-C kind of like plug, right? And the unit comes, maybe I can pull one of the units here to show you better. Just hold on one second.
Didn't they make like a Thingiverse or something so that you could 3D print your own enclosure if you wanted to do something else? I thought I saw something about that.
One person did. Sorry. Do this off if I'm doing something. All right. So I don't know if you can see this well enough. This is the male USB-C that goes under the hood into that female receptacle, right? And on the opposite side, there's a USB-A female plug, if that makes sense. So when you insert it sideways like this, you end up with a USB-A port flushed with the chassis of the laptop, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Instead of a USB-A, you can have a USB-C, so it will just be an extension of the internal USB-C thing, you know, or HDMI, or it may be like an external hard drive. In that case, there won't be anything here. It's just going to be like flashed, like a check, you know, like nothing, not no plug there. But this is a 1 terabyte USB-C external hard drive. Does that make sense?
Yeah, perfect. That's an amazing idea.
You know, and the other thing is that, you know, people already complained about not having a Ethernet connection. And I think they're aware, but I'm not sure if they are actually, how actively they are working on that. Because I think you can get Ethernet connection from USB-C, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, they make dongles that you can plug in. I know I have one that's a USB-A.
The other, one other person on YouTube, I can find it if you want me to. Not now, but maybe later. I can find it and send you the link. But the other person, what he did, very smart, was he actually disassembled the main board from the laptop. And then he 3D printed a mechanical keyboard chassis that would fit the main board inside. And then he essentially created a Pi 400 on like an Intel-based motherboard.
That's beautiful.
Don't you think? I mean, I thought it was genius, really. I mean, you know?
Yeah.
So it's very light. It's a keyboard, Pi 400, but it's only like Intel i7. You know, it's amazing, you know?
Just hope nobody steals your keyboard.
Absolutely. So, yeah. And, you know, the framework people actually advertise that on their like Twitter account that, you know, they weren't offended by that or anything like that. They thought this was the whole philosophy that, you know, create a lot of options, etc. After all, they are selling the product, you know what I mean? So, I mean, right now the options are limited. I think there's an i5, i7, two i7 options. One of them accommodates a newer, like a wireless, like the Wi-Fi module with the newest Wi-Fi capabilities. You know, I'm blanking on that one.
Wi-Fi 6?
I think so, yeah. But then you gotta get the better i7 for that. I got the previous i7 option. And I have the regular, like the Wi-Fi A, C, G, N, B, A, whatever, you know, so. And the,
that should,
you know,
be good enough.
You know, yeah, that is what I thought. The battery life, even with Linux, seems to be very reasonable. I didn't test it just on battery for 10 hours just to test. I didn't do that, admittedly. But I did use it without being connected to power for several hours at a time, and I didn't notice like a very quick drainage of the battery or anything like that. I thought the drainage speed was like very normal, I thought. And I can
very cool. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem at all. If you want me, I can try to do this. Like connect from the cell phone and maybe broadcast from there or something. I don't know. Can I do it? Maybe? Is it necessary?
I think we're okay here.
All right.
there for a while, we thought that it looked so, your graphics looked so well that we were under the impression you were like presenting from a different computer.
No.
Because it looks very Macintosh-y.
It is awesome. I mean, you know, I never used an Apple product so far. I mean, I never used that. But my daughter has one, you know. And I think the presentation, even using Arch Linux, which is not, I would say, probably the best polished Linux out there, which is not, you know.
But as a long-time Arch user, I disagree.
Oh, you do? Okay, well, maybe.
I think Arch Linux provides a very capable, solid KDE configuration.
That's what I'm using. Yeah,
I think their KDE configuration is really good. Some of their other configs aren't quite as good out the gate, I wouldn't say, but they really do. I think there's a fair number of KDE Arch Linux users, so I think they do a slightly better job.
I just like XFCE, but that's just personal taste.
Yeah. I've hopped DEs like every 3 or 4 years. I tend to hop a DE, but I'm really happy with the newest version of KDE as well. So
same here.
Thanks for showing it off.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, so what we can do here is I'll hit stop and